Hi and welcome to the channel. Today we will build another SFF PC using this PC Cooler i100-2, which I will interchangeably call as -2, V2, or version 2. As a background, 4 months ago I posted my build and review on the PC Cooler i100 Pro Mesh. It was definitely not a good result and I was blaming its wrong mesh design. Back then I also noted the difference in the design of this case and so I wanted to test it out. I bought this for 3,800 pesos or $70, which is relatively cheap although it doesn't include a PCIe riser yet, which you have to buy separately. As for the main difference of this version 2 with the Pro Mesh, on paper its GPU compatibility can accommodate a 3-slot 325mm GPU versus a 2-slot 300mm GPU for the Pro Mesh. Other than that, obviously the side panel is different as the V2 uses acrylic side panels rather than a mesh one. As compared to the A4 H2O, the V2 is slightly fatter to accept a 60mm cooler rather than a 55mm one from the A4 H2O. Although the A4 H2O is a lot taller to accommodate a 240mm radiator. Anyway, to open the case, you need to use your fingers to turn the thumb screw. Personally, I'd still prefer to have a screw head cut out since I have low dexterity. The side panels are pretty much the same and can be interchanged. As for the accessories, you have zip ties and screws. And I also like the bag as it is resealable. On the GPU side, you will see the cables. They are tied by a rubber band. It has a power switch, power LED, and HDD LED. Lastly, a USB 3. As for the motherboard side, you'd see the other end of the power extension cable. As for the front I/O, it only has a power switch and a USB 3. It also has a pre-installed handle, which is nice. As for the front, it is just a solid panel. To build on this case after removing the side panels, I suggest removing the PSU mount first. Put in the riser first as it will likely be tough to put later on. Set the case aside for now. As for the motherboard, I'll be using the ever usual B550i Aorus Pro AX and its processor, which I pre-installed, the Ryzen 7 5800X. I removed the original AM4 mounting bracket and backplate in preparation for the cooler that I chose. As for the best cooler that can fit this case, it would have been the IS55, but this motherboard, the IS55, and this case are not compatible with each other due to the limitation of orientation of the cooler to the motherboard. Do check out my review of IS55 for more details. With that, I'll be using the Alpenfon Black Ridge cooler. The intent is to configure the Black Ridge cooler to run in overclocking slim mode. The total height will be 62mm, so I will have a bulge in my side panels later on. With that, remove the included 90mm fan from the cooler, put in the AM4 mounting bracket. Also, don't forget to install the RAM first since the Black Ridge cooler will cover the RAM slots later on. For the RAM, I'll be using the Kingston Fury Beast non-RGB 32GB 3200MHz CL16 RAM. Apply thermal paste to the CPU, place the cooler upside down, cold plate facing you, flip the motherboard, and align the screw holes to the mounting bracket. Screw the motherboard to the cooler. Inspect if you have good contacts to the CPU, install the pesky fan clips, and then install the fan. Plug the fan to the motherboard fan header, plug the PCIe riser to the motherboard, and then I did a test fit if I can force the side panels to fit the 62mm cooler. And it can with a bulge. I removed the motherboard as I forgot another thing, which is to plug the CPU power connector. I would always plug first the CPU power connector to the motherboard as I find it difficult to plug when the motherboard is already installed to the case. After installing the motherboard, I plugged the USB 3 and front panel connectors. Install the 24-pin power connector as well. Now it's time to tackle the PSU. As for the PSU, I use the FSP Dagger Pro 850W Gold power supply. Mount into the PSU mounting brackets, plug the 24-pin PSU connectors, CPU and PCIe connectors as well. Plug the power extension cable and don't forget to turn on the PSU as you'd have no chance doing this later on. At this point, while screwing the PSU mount to the spine, the screws weren't aligning well. For that, you need to do some tilting to align it properly. To install the GPU, remove the PCIe covers. Initially, I wanted to fit in the ROG Strix RTX 3070, but I was hitting the power extension cable as the GPU is too wide, or in this scenario, too tall. I then tried to install Sapphire Nitro Plus RX 6800. It managed to fit in on the power extension cable side, but I then hit the USB 3 front panels. I actually wanted this to work, so I tried forcing it, but I felt uncomfortable with the idea and scrapped it. The next best idea is to remove the USB 3 header completely, but it looks like a hassle to do so. At this point, I was just really disappointed. With that, I installed a safer choice, which is the Gigabyte RTX 3060 Gaming OC. Definitely shorter and easier to install. While your GPU is not in the case, plug it to the riser and install the PCIe power connector. To perfectly align the screw holes, I suggest screwing the baffle side loosely first screw the riser to the spine, and then tighten the screw to the baffle. Screw this thing as well, which I don't know what to call. Install the side panels, and at this point, it was ready to test it. As for testing, there were no issues and it booted immediately. As for the temps, while benchmarking Cinebench R23 for 30 minutes, the CPU temps hovered at 90 degrees Celsius, which is pretty much expected. As for the temps, while benchmarking FF15 for 30 minutes, the CPU temps averaged at 70.42 degrees Celsius with a max temp of 81.4 degrees Celsius. The GPU temps averaged at 76.39 degrees Celsius with a max temp of 78 degrees Celsius. The GPU hotspot temps averaged at 87.46 degrees Celsius with a max temp of 89 degrees Celsius. The GPU fans averaged at 88.56% and hovered at 90%, which means that it was pretty loud. At this point, it was actually difficult for me to tell whether the temperature performance of the V2 is better than the PC Cooler i100 Mesh Pro. In my previous builds, I don't typically maintain an ambient temp, and so it's not fair to compare with my previous results of the Mesh Pro. With that, I dismantled the build early on, installed the components on the Mesh Pro, and retested it. It was a direct transfer since the GPU that I used for that build is the same as in this build. After the transfer, I ran FF15 benchmarks again for 30 minutes in the Mesh Pro, and the CPU temps averaged at 81.24 degrees Celsius with a max temp of 89.1 degrees Celsius. The Mesh Pro was clearly worse by a significant 10.82 degrees Celsius as compared to the V2. However, for the GPU temps, it wasn't significant as the average in Mesh Pro was 77.15 degrees Celsius with a max temp of 79.7 degrees Celsius. The GPU hotspot temps were at an average of 88.09 degrees Celsius with a max temp of 90.9 degrees Celsius. The Mesh Pro was just 1 degree Celsius worse than the V2. As for the fan speed, in Mesh Pro, the GPU fan was at an average of 89.22% with a max of 93%, just 3% worse, which is also around 120 RPM faster and noisier. The results were unexplainable to me as to why I see a huge improvement in CPU but not much in GPU. Is my GPU broken again? With that, I retested the temps of the GPU in my open test bench and it averaged at 66.5 degrees Celsius while the hotspot temps averaged at 77.15 degrees Celsius. The fans were at an average of 75.44%, which was still aligned to how I perceived it back then. Anyway, it's normal to see this difference between an open test bench and a closed test bench. In retrospect, the CPU was around 14 degrees Celsius worse in V2, which is hotter than what I'd like it to be, but acceptable overall. Moving on, as for the cons of this case, well, for one, I can't find official info about this case on PC Cooler's website, meaning there was no official compatibility guide, and I'm not even sure if this was released by PC Cooler for that matter. The only best spec that I found about this case is from the Lazada seller, which tells you something about compatibility. Next is that there was no manual in the case, unlike the Mesh Pro, although you can just refer to this video as a build guide. Next is the position of the power extension cable and especially the USB 3, which is really bad for long GPUs. That affects the next point, which is its compatibility doesn't make sense at all. If you can accommodate a long 325mm GPU, you should also be able to accommodate a wide one as well. Most triple fan GPUs will grow diagonally rather than horizontally, as it doesn't make sense to have a long GPU with a long shroud but small fans. I believe this is a big design oversight. As for the pros of this case, well, it has better and acceptable CPU temps, especially versus i100 Mesh Pro. The triple slot design would also make it compatible with Zotac RTX 4070 Ti, which is probably the most powerful card that you can fit in this case. And of course, overall, it is cheap at 3,800 pesos. As for overall recommendation, holistically speaking, it is not that bad. Not that great, but also not terrible as well, especially considering its price at 3,800 pesos or $70. I wouldn't strongly recommend it, but it's not something that you should avoid as well. Just be careful with the GPU that you intend to put here, as it might not fit. I suggest double checking the width of your GPU to be at most 120mm. But as compared to the PC Cooler i100 Mesh Pro, I'd definitely choose the V2. It isn't much bigger in terms of perceived volume, but it is much better in CPU cooling. Okay, so that's it for this video. Comment down below on what you think of this case. Also, as a reminder, if you're new to the channel, I do one SFF build monthly, so subscribe if you want more of this content. Thanks for watching, do like or dislike, and subscribe for more unboxing, SFF build, and benchmarks. Bye!